Your Honors.
My name is Daniel Roth, and I have the privilege of representing the appellants in this case, the Center for Biological Diversity and the Maricopa Audubon Society. With this court's permission, I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. A decade ago, a former colleague of mine at our law school's environmental law clinic also stood before this court arguing a case involving the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's policy on distinct population segments, or DPSs, under the Endangered Species Act. Her clients in Northwest's Ecosystem Alliance versus the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, a decision the parties in this case cite extensively in their briefs, challenged the DPS policies for assessing the significance of a population to its taxon as a whole as focused too much on genetics. This court rejected that characterization of the agency's DPS policy, observing that, quote, the significance requirement may be satisfied not only by genetic differences, but also by the population's persistence in unusual ecological settings, its status as the only natural occurrence of a taxon, or evidence that its loss would result in a significant gap, close quote. The court therefore quoted the DPS policy's 4 indicators that a population is significant to its taxon. Following this court's lead, for years, everyone has believed that if at least one of these 4 indicators of significance applies to a given discrete population, that population will trigger a finding by the Fish and Wildlife Service that the population is significant to its taxon as a whole. And that's exactly how the Fish and Wildlife Service has implemented this policy for the past 2 decades. For example, in the agency's 2015 finding on sage grouse, Fish and Wildlife Service asserted that, quote, a population needs to satisfy only one of these conditions, referring to the 4 explicit indicators of significance in its DPS policy, to be considered significant, close quote. Taking Fish and Wildlife Service at its word, courts have refereed many battles over whether a population meets at least one of these 4 indicators of significance under the DPS policy. In numerous court cases involving disputes over the population's status as a DPS, including several cases before this court, the parties have litigated over whether a population meets one of those 4 enumerated indicators of significance.
Mr. Roth, let me interrupt. I thought that there were 4 non-exclusive factors that were considered when you evaluate significant. You could have all 4 and win. You could have all 4 and lose. But you're telling me once you get 1, you win?
That's correct, Your Honor. In fact, the agency, as I just noted, the agency has always applied its policy in saying that, again, here's a quote from its 2015 sage grouse listing decision, quote, a population needs to satisfy only one of these conditions to be considered significant, close quote.
Well, but that doesn't mean that if you satisfy one, that always means that you win. I mean, sometimes if you satisfy one, that'll do the trick.
Actually, Your Honor, courts look to the Fish and Wildlife Service's listing decisions over time to help it interpret the agency's DPS policy.
No, I understand that.
And there is not one instance where the Fish and Wildlife Service has determined that a population inhabits a unique ecosystem, where the Fish and Wildlife Service has not then gone on to determine that that population is significant.
So, tell me more in commonsensical terms with respect to the bald eagle that you're interested in here. Why, in your view, the Fish and Wildlife Service has made a mistake?
Because, Your Honor, the agency has simply disregarded its policy. It found that desert eagles inhabit an ecosystem that's unique for the species, and that is one of the 4 explicit indicators of significance that the agency has always applied. to its policy, and the agency has always said if a population meets one of these indicators of significance, we will find that it's significant. And the agency cannot point to any other decision that the agency has made where it has made this sort of finding and still not found the population significant.
Well, you know, what you say can't be right in the way that you just said it. I think it's correct that where they are is a unique setting. I get that. And certainly if they existed, if the bald eagle existed only there, I would get it, and I think it would have been under an abuse of discretion. But it's possible to have some species, I'm now talking generically, I'm not talking with respect to the bald eagle, that occupies a number of geographical areas, and some of those geographical areas are unique. But if it's the same species and it's actually very successful in lots of specific areas, the fact that it exists in this, among other places, unique area doesn't mean that you get a sublisting for that population, does it?
Well, Your Honor, that's really kind of the nub of this question. And in fact, it's instructive to compare two of these sorts of situations. So there was another listing by the Fish and Wildlife Service, or another consideration of a listing, this one involving sage grouse, greater sage grouse. And one of the things that the agency looked at in that citation, by the way, is 80 Federal Register 59858. One of the things the agency looked at in that instance was whether sage grouse in the Columbia Basin inhabited a unique ecosystem. And the service looked over the range of greater sage grouse generally and determined that sage grouse inhabited a variety of conditions. And though the conditions in the Columbia Basin were somewhat different, this was an adaptable, wide-ranging species. And so the agency found, quote, although the Columbia Basin differs in some ways from other habitats that the greater sage grouse inhabits, it is not unusual for the greater sage grouse range-wide, given the diversity of sagebrush habitat the species utilizes across its range, close quote.
And the consequences?
And then the service determined that the population did not inhabit a unique ecosystem and therefore was not significant to the taxon as a whole.
So why is this case different from that? Because I can read that language and see that because this to a T.
Well, Your Honor, it's very different because based on the administrative record and based on the clear and consistent findings by the Fish and Wildlife Service biologists in Arizona repeatedly over many years, actually, the Fish and Wildlife Service said, yes, bald eagles can inhabit a wide variety of areas. However, this one is actually unique for the species. It's so different. It's so hot. There's no other place where bald eagles nest in a desert. And so even though this species is a habitat generalist, this represents a unique ecosystem for the species. Now, if the agency believed that, in fact, this was not a unique ecosystem, the agency could have made the same finding as it did with respect to Columbia sage grouse.
So unique is an odd word. When we're talking real estate, if we're talking good old-fashioned contract law, any piece of real estate is unique. And, of course, the desert is not unique in some sense because it shares common characteristics with the rest of the landmass. It has mountains, it has dirt, it has sand, it occasionally has water, it has plant life. So the question is not unique in some absolute sense. The question is degree of difference. And I think the desert is very different. But unique is an odd word. And I'm not sure how still to differentiate this case from the Columbia Basin case.
Well, Your Honor, I agree, but the Fish and Wildlife Service developed this criterion in its significance policy, whether a population inhabits a unique or unusual ecosystem for the species. And that determination is therefore up to the agency to determine, based on its expertise, when an ecosystem is or is not unique. And here we have a clear line, because for Columbia sage grouse, Fish and Wildlife Service looked at this species and said it ranges across a wide variety of habitats. The Columbia Basin is not unique for this species.
It's a slightly different question, but relevant to the question case in front of us. This population in the desert seems to be, in the Fish and Wildlife Service, it seems to have concluded that it's actually quite robust. How do you respond to that?
Your Honor, that issue was not decided by the district court. And, you know, the government actually says this case, this appellate court should decide an issue that was briefed below and simply not even decided by the appellate court. I'm not a biologist, Your Honor. However, I do dabble a bit in that area in my teaching, and this population is actually very small. This population actually faces a number of habitat threats. And in fact, the agency biologist in the agency's Arizona office made a draft determination that the population should be listed as a threatened species. That later was reversed by the agency's Washington, D.C. office, and the parties briefed that question extensively before the district court, which did not decide that issue.
Mr. Roth, this won't come as a surprise to you. I think it's Rule 47 of the appellate rules. They have a way of saying the Court of Appeals say, see well-reasoned opinion of district court. I'd like to see that in my work, okay? And I went to the excerpts of record here, and I want to ask about Judge Campbell's decision to see if I understand your argument. Here's what Judge Campbell said. Plaintiffs argue that the plain language of this persistence factor should control. If a population persists in an ecological setting that is unique or unusual for the species, this factor is satisfied and supports a finding that the population is significant to the species as a whole. He drops down, and here's what he says, Judge Campbell. The court does not find that DPS policy should be read as rigidly as plaintiffs suggest. Isn't that the nub of the case?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
And in this case, we encourage this court to simply follow the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
Well, the reason I ask you that is he goes on to cite to the 61 Federal Register at 4725, which is found in the briefs, of course. Here's what he says, Judge Campbell. He says, the policy does not state that a population is significant merely because it persists in a unique ecological setting. Persistence is one of four significant factors identified in the policy, and the policy expressly states that the agency's analysis, quote, may include but is not limited to these factors.
That's correct, Your Honor.
That's not your argument.
Now, Your Honor, so this case actually provides a good illustration of the non-exclusive nature of those four factors. As I mentioned before, in the past, the Fish and Wildlife Service has explicitly said, and parties have litigated over this in probably dozens of cases, if one of these four enumerated factors is met by a population, we say it's significant. And so parties, this court has entertained questions.
Significant. We can say it's significant, or we must say it's significant. Those are very different concepts.
The agency itself has specified that it will say a population is significant if the agency finds one of those factors met.
Okay, we understand your position. Now, you're way down on time.
Yes, Your Honor.
So we hear from the other side, and then we'll give you a chance to respond.
Thank you, Your Honor.
But we won't cut you off. We'll make sure you get a chance to say what you need to say.
Great.
May it please the Court, Mark Haig from the Department of Justice for the Fish and Wildlife Service. I guess before we get into the nitty-gritty, I'd like to step back a little bit to talk about the overall legal framework here, because there are a couple of issues there that I think are also important. The first is that the agency's decision here not to list the Sonoran population of eagles as a DPS does not mean that the eagle will not be protected under federal law or under state law. The eagle continues to be protected under the Bald and Golden Eagle Protection Act, the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, the Southwest Bald Eagle Management Committee, the Arizona Nesting Monitoring Provisions. So there are a lot of other provisions in place. Listing a species as endangered under the ESA is kind of like, is the wildlife law equivalent of sending something to the intensive care unit. And the fact that the eagle is no longer in the intensive care unit does not mean it is not protected and worthy of protection. Second, in talking about significance here, I want to be clear, I think the court understands, but I want to emphasize this, that we're talking about significance in a narrow legal technical sense for purposes of the distinct population segment policy. We're not talking about whether the eagle is of value. The tribes of the Southwest in particular place a lot of cultural significance, to use the same word, on the eagle. This decision has nothing to do with, it is separate from that, is distinct from that.
Counsel, the thing that bothered me the most about this case was the history. And one could come away with the impression that there had already been a decision in the highest political circles as to what the outcome of this case would be, and marching orders were given for the Fish and Wildlife Service to come to that conclusion. What's your response to that?
A couple of responses. First, the Inspector General's office investigated those allegations of marching orders and found, and it's in our record, we cited in our brief, that there was no evidence of improper political influence. This is Julie McDonald.
Was there evidence of proper political influence?
No, there was no evidence of that either. There was a dispute between, thank you, there was a dispute between different, within different levels of the department as to how to approach this species, as to what the facts should. Second,
I have to say there was a period during which the then vice president intervened in a number of environmental disputes. I'm thinking, for example, of the Klamath River basin and the water coming down out of there. I mean, this suspicion does not come out of nowhere.
No, that's certainly true. And the Inspector General's report addresses, it goes through, I think, 20-some-odd cases and identifies cases where there was political influence or the people involved thought that there was political influence. And it determines that this is not, that there was no political influence here, that Julie McDonald was not involved. But the second part of the question is, when the case was remanded, when Judge Campbell remanded the decision the second time in 2010 or 2011, the Fish and Wildlife Service's analysis of the issue of the facts on remand was assigned to a different team of career people. So a new group of scientists, biologists looked at this, and the 2012 decision that's on review here was made by a different group.
Were those newly assigned scientists aware of all of the emails and all of the correspondence and all of the disagreements that had taken place historically in this case?
They worked, yes, because they worked from the same record. I mean, I don't know whether each of them read all of the emails.
But they would have been exposed.
They were exposed to it, certainly.
Mr. Hagen, I didn't understand from the record, why did Judge Campbell, he said he sent it back for notice and comment. Was there evidence taken? He wasn't pleased with the record when it came to him the first time. Why? But I didn't understand why. Did the agency not comply with?
I think it was a procedural problem, and I'll confess I'm blanking on this a little bit.
What procedure did
that the agency relied on aspects of its 2008 decision that Judge Marguia had decided were procedurally improper, and so the court sent it back, and Judge Campbell directed the agency to specifically address this issue of whether the agency was being inconsistent in its application of the policy, and the agency did that as well, and that's in our supplemental excerpts.
Wasn't that Judge Murguia's concern that initially the agency came out one way and then came out a different way, and then there was no notice, no comment on the different outcome. That was what I thought.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, my head is so full of species, I'm not up on the procedure.
Drugs, it is all right.
Thank you. I guess talking about whether this decision is consistent with the policy or not, I think the court's questions reflect that you are familiar with the policy, that the way that the policy is written, it's may consider it's a list of potential factors that are not mandatory.
Well, so counsel, do you agree or disagree with the opposing counsel's position that in the history of applying this regulation, that any time there was one of the factors present, that there had been a finding of distinct population segment? Do you disagree with that representation?
I do disagree with that, Your Honor, and I put a finer point on it than that, but I'm identifying three species, the mountain whitefish, the Arctic grayling, and the Pacific, the northern Rocky Mountain population of the fisher, all of which are discussed in the supplemental excerpts, and I can give Federal Register sites as well. But those are all species where the agency said this habitat is unusual or unique, but it's not unique enough or unusual enough that it's biologically significant. And the mountain whitefish is a really interesting example of this. It's the Big Lost River, the Lost Big River population of mountain whitefish. It's discussed, the Federal Register site is 75 Fed Reg 17352. The mountain whitefish on the Big Lost River is an isolated drainage. And for 10,000 years, those whitefish have been in a drainage where there are no other large fish, so they don't have to compete with trout or suckers. There's no other drainage like that of mountain whitefish. So in that sense, it is, you know, it's a dictionary definition of unique. There's nothing else like it. However, the agency found that there was no indication that this had any biological significance, because once trout were introduced into that system 100 years ago, there was no apparent effect on mountain whitefish.
So, counsel, where did you say we may go to the excerpts of record to find these three examples?
There's a memo discussing the history of the application of the DPS policy. That's the sole document that's in the United States supplemental excerpts of record.
Where is that?
SER 5-6 is where the whitefish is discussed. The Arctic grayling is discussed at SER 7. The fisher is discussed at SER 4. And then I gave you the Federal Register site. The Federal Register sites are not in the SER, but these are the listings that the memo is discussing. The alternative reading that appellants are raising here produces this absurd result that's inconsistent with the purposes of the policy. The absurd result, and I think Judge Fletcher, you alluded to this in one of your questions, is that anytime you have an isolated population of some species, it has to be listed. So the example that Congress discusses, or this Senate committee report that's cited in the DPS policy discusses, is squirrels in a city park. It's an isolated population, but it's of no significance because to the population as a whole. Another example would be in Queens, where I'm from, and in Chicago, there are populations of monk parrots. That the monk parrot is a subtropical species from South America, but they build nests on telephone poles in Queens and in apartment house air shafts in Chicago, where there's enough heat for them to survive. Under CBD's reading of this policy, that the fact that population is distinct would trigger a finding that it's significant. that's not the goal of the Act. The goal of the Act is to preserve important genetic diversity. The agency has a backlog of cases of species. It issues a list every year of all the species that it thinks are warranted for listing but precluded because it doesn't have the resources to get to them. And there are about 50 species on that list as of right now. So the agency has to devote its resources to species that it thinks don't have genetic significance, biological significance to the taxon as a whole. That has real consequences for these warranted but precluded species that are on the, that the agency thinks warrant protection, but the agency is not able to get to.
I don't understand that last argument. I understand the nature of this list. It does have a backlog. I've had cases involving the backlog. But I don't see how changing the criteria, as you say the criteria would be changed, would affect the backlog. I mean, you've got to apply different criteria, but, I mean, you just apply different criteria.
If any time the agency finds that a species is in an unusual place, it has to find that it's significant.
Well, bingo, then the fact that makes it easier, you can clear your backlog more easily. You just designate it as listed and move on.
Well, once it's listed, though, there are consequences to that, too. The agency has to designate critical habitat. The agency has to prepare a recovery plan. And all of those things impose burdens on the agency, too. Congress, in the legislative history, and the agency, in the policy, focus on the word that's used in the legislative history is sparingly. The DPS policy should be used sparingly. And focusing on the species that are of the most biological concern, or the population segments that are of biological significance, is the way to ensure that the policy is used sparingly and consistent with the purposes of the statute. If there are no further questions, I will sit down.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Why don't you put 2 minutes on the clock?
Your Honor, we respectfully believe that counsel for the government's characterizations of the Fish and Wildlife Service's listing decisions are not quite accurate. So I think if you look at the species that were referenced, the Fish and Wildlife Service actually did not find that those populations inhabit an ecosystem that is unique or unusual to the species, and therefore find that those populations were not significant. In fact, that has not happened. And so the parade of horribles that counsel presents where squirrels in a city park will be listed is not the case. It's only if the Fish and Wildlife Service, in using its discretion, finds that a population inhabits an ecosystem that is unusual or unique for the species. The absurd situation that would be created, Your Honors, under the government's interpretation, brand new interpretation, by the way, of its DPS policy, is that the court and the agency may then as well throw out the policy. Because for the last 20 years, the agency has said, if a population meets one of these criteria, it's significant. Now the agency is saying, significance is whatever we say it is. It can meet one of these criteria, it cannot meet one of these criteria, it's whatever we say it is.
Opposing counsels rely on the broad discretion that's given to the agency in the overall statement of the regulation. What's your response to that?
My response to that, Your Honor, is the DPS policy was precisely the agency's effort to explain to everyone, including itself, how it would use its discretion and how it would define a distinct population segment. So that policy very carefully enumerates indicators of significance.
But does that mean that the agency can never exercise its discretion in a different way?
The agency could, if it changed its policy and acknowledged it was changing the policy and said, now we're going to look at significance in a different way. And in fact, that's precisely what virtually all Fish and Wildlife Service personnel in Arizona, including the Fish and Wildlife Service Region 2 director, sent a memorandum, which we cite on page 11 of our opening brief, to the Washington, D.C. office and said, hey, you guys are changing the DPS policy by saying that desert eagles don't meet the policy even though they live in a unique ecosystem, and that's fine if you want to do that, but we think we should notify the public. So even the Fish and Wildlife Service itself agrees with the position that my clients take in this case.
Mr. Croft, was it your 28-J letter that you sent Judge Paez's opinion, Assistant Administrators for Fisheries, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration? Did you send that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Because one thing you haven't talked about that I was interested in is you claim, the way I get your brief, that the agency didn't address climate change. I think that's what Pritzker is about, the case you sent, right?
That case does address climate change, Your Honor. And yes, we did. One of our arguments is indeed that the agency personnel in the region and the draft findings address climate change, but the final significance determination did not consider that at all.
Here's what the district judge said. As discussed at length above, the 2012 finding, that's what we are reviewing, isn't it?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yeah, as discussed at length above, the 2012 finding considered carefully whether the desert eagle has adapted to the desert environment in ways that would help bald eagles generally, and could find no evidence that it has. This inquiry essentially answered the question posed by plaintiff's climate change argument, whether desert eagles have unique characteristics that could help bald eagles as a whole in the era of global warming. Given this detailed analysis of adaptation in the 2012 finding, the court cannot conclude that the finding is fatally flawed. Didn't they discuss and reject climate change as a significant factor?
No, Your Honor, climate change was never mentioned. All of the issues that Judge Campbell discussed was Judge Campbell's efforts at sort of being an amateur biologist to say, this is why desert eagles won't be important to the population as a whole, given climate change.
Well, he cites to the administrative record 2012 AR at page 451.
Your Honor, if you look at the final finding, nowhere in the significance discussion, absolutely nowhere, does the Fish and Wildlife Service discuss climate change. So that was simply post hoc reasoning by Judge Campbell. Thank you.
Thank you both sides for your helpful arguments. Case Center for Biological Diversity versus Jewell, now submitted for decision. The next case on the calendar this morning, Pro Builders Specialty Insurance versus Valley Coating.